So, yeah, my name is Andre, and I'm gonna talk about DevOps transformations. Like, with this one X, it's not the like the killing sign; it's actually the you know improvement sign. So, who am I? I'm a developer. Actually, I do a lot of things. I do team leading. I do trainings. I do speaking. I co-organize some things. But my main mindset that I usually position myself as a developer, because I have developed mindset, I approach a lot of things as a developer, and that's actually influenced a lot in how I feel, how I do. So a few words about things that I do. One thing is Devternity. Maybe you heard of that, maybe you didn't. It's a conference in Riga that happens like in December every year, and it's going to be fifth edition this year, so please take a look at the program. Also, I do a little thing that's called DevTube, which is like a aggregator video, video aggregator for developer-oriented videos. That's what things I do. But let's talk about, you know, transformations and how tools are important and how culture is more important or less important. And how many people here are actually engineers, like software developers, QA people? Most of you, right. So have you ever heard about DevOps tools? Yes. Name at least one or two. Rundeck, okay. Any other?
Jenkins,
okay. any other options?
Rumble.
Which one? Okay. Bamboo, of course, yeah. Now I hear that. Yeah, well, kind of yes, kind of no, because, and the thing is that when people hear word DevOps, many of them, especially managers, they think that DevOps is really about technology, is really about tooling, is really about, you know, finding those magic DevOps engineers. By the way, any DevOps engineers in the room? Good. Yeah, because well, honestly, I think DevOps engineer is a very bad term, and people with this profession don't really exist because it's ridiculous definition. But anyway, well, the thing is that, you know, engineers, we like tooling, of course. I'm an engineer myself. I'm a geek. I'm a nerd. I like playing with these tools. And many other people also like. And of course, when you, in the last, like, I don't know, 10 years, 15 years, we have a proliferation of so many different tools that have appeared on the market. And you have to find, you know, you have to be sane and try to select the one that was just the best one. And many people tried. So they created this picture called, well, actually called Periodic Table of DevOps Tools. The funny thing is that if you go to Google Image Search tab and you type in DevOps Tools, you will find this picture, of course. It's going to be the first, most likely. But then you will also find this one, and this one, and this one, and this one. And this one, and well, you guessed that. It's ocean of tools that exist in order to, you know, help you with your automation, with your transformation, with anything that you would like to be like automatic and nice. The problem with this ocean of tools, the selection of these tools is very hard. And quite often, at least in my experience, quite often engineers, they tend to select the tools rather than actually focusing on something that is more important, which I think it's like planning or organizing culture around how you deliver the product. Do you have to plan the projects or like things like that? And but at the same time, the ocean of tools that exist at the moment, it makes this problem even harder. If any of you have ever been like in some DevOps conferences or have read some DevOps material before, you would hear a lot that DevOps is not about tools. On the other hand, our industry still is kind of merging into the fact that people think that it is about tools. But at the same time, if you go to real DevOps communities, you will hear that it's not about tools. It's about more being more agile, being more lean. But at the same time, if you think about it, like what is like the real values and what is like the tooling it brings us, quite often we couldn't deliver our culture and deliver the way we want to work together without tools being around. Just think about the history. Think about the history, and without having like proper tooling from like Stone Age, we would never evolve into a civilization that we are now. And of course, without having proper tooling in your company, in your or team, you would never be able to, you know, deliver something that is like fast enough or valuable. And it's kind of, you know, tools are our weapons. They actually help to protect, to some extent, help to protect our cultural values. Without being technologically advanced civilization, we would never be able to build theaters or to build libraries or collect our knowledge, build cloud providers and all that stuff. Tools actually are quite important to protect our culture, and that's what they are initially designed for. So we use it to protect our culture. But at the same time, tooling and culture is kind of, you know, they always go hand in hand, and there is also a way that we can misuse the tools. So we can also try to see that these tools is used by these big unicorn companies, and we just try to use the same, and at the same time we don't get the same success as this big unicorn. Have you heard about Carrier Cult? I guess you did, right? And Carrier Culting, sorry. Okay. And the thing is that, well, Carrier Culting is happening all over the place, and it's happening in agile communities, it's happening in DevOps communities, it's happening in every organization that is trying to achieve the same success, let's say, as Facebook or Spotify or Netflix, or and smaller companies are trying to replicate what those big companies are doing, and they fail by building something that they don't understand, of course. Let me give you another example. So big companies or small companies and old companies, new companies, of course, all of them tend to be more healthy and tend to be more like growing faster organically. And we can also apply this kind of analogy to human life. So of course, everybody in this room, I guess, wants to be more healthy, or at least to have a healthy lifestyle. That's natural. I have a story about that. So I have a friend, and he's a bit fatter than me, maybe like this. And at some point, of course, he realized that his health is not ideal, and he wants to like to improve that. And he thought, like, everybody is running, and everybody's using running, you know, to start getting into shape. And he decided that that's the thing for him. So he started running. He bought his new, like, you know, sports shoes, new T-shirt, and, you know, one day on Monday he went out of the room and started running. You know what happened? In first 5 minutes, he broke his leg. The reason he broke his leg, not because he fell or not because he was not sporty enough, but because his body accumulated so much weight over the years that his bones, when he started running, his bones, the stress applied to his bones became much bigger because of the inertia, and basically the bone has been broken. So that's the thing that happens in organizations as well, especially the ones that want to apply technology or tool or technique they've seen somewhere without trying to understand what is this technique is good for, and how should I prepare myself to use that technique. And unfortunately, well, my friend, he regretted starting running because, you know, breaking the leg is kind of a big thing. And he said that, running doesn't work. He blamed running for his problems. He said, running is not for me, and it's for some other people, for healthy people. So you see, you know, in order to become healthy, you have to use a technique that makes you hurt, which is a bad thing for him. And this thing happens in companies as well, in organizations. And unfortunately, if you want to be a healthy person, or if you want to have a more healthier and more faster growing organization, you have to combine things. You cannot just take one technique like agile or lean or use one tool or another and think that it will make you happy. Most likely it will not, because it's, in most of the cases, it's a combination of things. You have to use different type of tool, less extreme. Maybe you use a different diet. Maybe have more sleeping time. Maybe make some activities, not just, you know, sitting on the sofa. I mean, the same thing works for the companies. You cannot just make an agile transformation without actually changing the mindsets of different teams, and also involving testers, infrastructure development, developers, and also change the leadership without having a combined transformation. You will never achieve a healthy lifestyle, because you may implement agile in a small subset of projects, but it will not lead you to a better organization. So again, it's about, well, running is the tool. Running is a technique that you can use. Agile is a technique that you can use. But the way you apply that technique to your company, to your context of your team, is basically the level of your culture, the level of the way you're applying the different techniques in the context that you are in. So let me show you some technical details about how my I'm a consultant, so I work as a freelance consultant, and quite often I come to companies and talk to them about how they can improve. Usually it starts from like tooling conversations, but quite often I see that it's not really about the tools. It's quite often it's really about some deeper problems that exist in the company. So imagine I have this kind of conversation quite often. So I come to a customer and asking them, how much time does it take to get a new machine for you, like a new virtual machine? And well, I get this kind of number some quite often. Well, not that often nowadays, but a few years ago was quite a common answer, that it takes 6 weeks, and it takes maybe a couple of weeks to get a firewall sorted. So people waiting for the resources have to wait 8 weeks, 2 months before they get that. I mean, this problem can be solved with some tooling. I mean, you can go to the cloud, you can maybe buy more infrastructure in your own data center, but at the same time, if these guys, they still think that 8 weeks is okay, they're fine with waiting. And being fine with waiting for a resource is part of the company culture, not part of, you know, tooling. And the thing is, I can help this company to, you know, set up the tooling, but still, being fine with waiting is something that should be fixed in the heads, which is much harder. Another conversation. Well, a bit better company, where I'm asking how much time does it take to get a new environment to test your product, to test your feature. And they say that, okay, it's like 2-3 days for the infrastructure, maybe another week for database. And again, they say it's not long. Honestly, guys, I mean, I can start environments in the cloud, like in minutes. And when I see that companies are fine with waiting for 2-3 days or maybe a week to get an environment, that's something that is wrong in their heads. And 2-3 days is really a big thing. Another one. So I'm coming to a company, they ask me to do a training. I'm a Java developer, so I also do, sometimes I do Java trainings. And they say that we need a training, and I'm asking them, what is the experience your developers have? And they tell me that, no, it's not for your developers. It's for our system administrators, because we want them to debug applications in production, which is not a bad thing. I mean, it's cool when a system admin can actually debug application in production. It's great. But the problem with this company was that actually their developers were working from 9 to 5. But their system admins were staying there all night, finding the errors that developers have introduced during the day. And that is part of the company culture. So instead of changing the developers and changing the product that they're actually delivering with having more monitoring, having a better logging system, or having at least a sensible way of, you know, finding the metrics about the application, they decided that it's better to teach sysadmins to actually do debugging in production, which obviously, well, it's not a good thing, at least from my opinion. So again, it's an indication that, you know, this company's cultural level is that they tend to push the problem down without trying to actually implement the better solution on the whole system. That's a big problem to me. Another one is that, well, I guess most of you have heard about Docker and Kubernetes. At least you know the words. And I quite often get requests: can we set up Kubernetes? Can we, you know, Dockerize our applications? And usually I help, but in this particular case, I get an answer that, well, we have a single monolithic, like big one single deploy application. We want to deploy it to Kubernetes. And we want to do that because we think that our operations, our sysadmins, are slow in deploying that. So this indicates that, first of all, devs and ops, they do not talk. They actually are enemies instead of being friends. And also the fact that actually the problem is that they have a huge application that has to be split into smaller components first before they can actually take advantage of any advanced technology like Docker or Kubernetes. And this, again, this is a cultural issue. That's not an issue of the tool. I can install the tool. I can help them to adopt the tool. But still, the problem is in the heads. They think that adopting the tool will help them to be more efficient, which most likely will not happen. And quite often what I see, like in big companies and small companies, is that their communication is broken. And devs are on one side, operations are on the other side, and the feedback loop is probably coming only one way. So these guys never complain that, you know, your application that you deliver to us is actually bad. They never complain, just try to, you know, cope with the situation. They try to be as efficient as they could with the given conditions, but they never complain back. So the feedback loop about how good is the product in terms of operations is never closed. It's one-way communication, which is a bad thing, obviously. Another thing that I see, you know, in big companies and small companies, well, especially in big companies, is that, well, developers more or less agree on the method of delivery. Of course, it's agile. Of course, we do it in iterations. We do it with often delivery of features, probably working in cross-functional teams. But at the same time, operations are quite often left behind. They are living in their own realm. They are optimizing for their own good. And there's quite often the boundaries between different types of infrastructure they have to support. Sorry. So that's really an issue. And that's an issue that has to be solved. Now, how Ilya was actually putting that in the keynote, that you have to have a cross-functional team and cross-component team. I actually had a real situation when we had a problem in application and in load balancer and in the database. But the problem is that teams were geographically separated. One was in the US, another one is in Denmark, third one was in India. And to solve a system problem across different teams that were trying to optimize for themselves, and besides were also geographically separated, was really a difficult thing. So of course these boundaries have to be broken. So, and the question is it really like lack of tooling? Because in most of the cases, those guys know their tools, they know how to use a specific part of what they're optimizing for, but they have no culture of working together, working for the product, working for the value of the company, and that's really an issue. Some of them actually lack tooling. Yeah, some of them, yes. Some of them work in an old-fashioned manual way, and some of the problems can be solved with tools. But in most of the cases, it's not about the tools. It's really about how they work together and how they optimize for the business. Okay, let me get into a bit of history, and I guess you all most know all that. So, you know, Agile was born around 2001. You know the principles. I don't need to repeat them. What happened in 2003? You probably know this woman. It's Mary Popendick. She wrote a book about lean software development, and you probably have heard about lean not in relation to software, because the Lean framework actually is much older than that. And she also defined these principles like eliminate waste, amplify learning, empower the team, build integrity, and see the whole. So system thinking is here. In 2008, because you know infrastructure and anything that is related to management of pipelines and networks, databases, and all that stuff, but was still lagging behind the ideas that were put in by Agile and Lean. In 2008, people started thinking in that direction. So maybe you've heard about this guy, Andrew Clay Schaeffer. He actually created this term: infrastructure is code. So he started it was already possible to some extent in 2008 to actually describe some of the aspects of your infrastructure in the form of code and make like the state management of that. Later on, this guy, Patrick Dubois, maybe you heard about him as well. He started thinking that maybe infrastructure that was actually quite rigid back in the days should actually also be more agile, more ready, not be like a stopper or a showstopper, but actually be like an enabler for teams that are delivering features, delivering code, and delivering products. So he thought about like, why not make our infrastructure more agile? The term agile infrastructure came into place. And later on, these two guys, actually Andrew Clay Schaeffer and Patrick Dubois, they coined the term DevOps, because it was apparent that, you know, developing new feature, new functionality is quite hard without involving operations, but at the same time, operations has to change in order to apply similar principles, similar ideas that developers and product owners and some other guys actually are using. So DevOps joined these things together and is starting to evolve. And if you read that, the definition of DevOps, actually there are many. There are many definitions of DevOps. Unfortunately, well, actually, I think actually fortunately, because in the beginning, when DevOps community on the start to be defined, they decided not to give a definition to DevOps. And they actually allowed the definition to evolve over the years. So the community defined that. The practices defined that. But what it came down to eventually is that DevOps aims to shorter development cycles, increase deployment frequency, and more dependable releases in close alignment with our business objectives. How does it sound? It's agile. Obviously it is. And also, well, Ilya was talking about smaller cycles as well during the keynote. That's really the same thing as agile. Just, you know, it takes a bit of technical angle of how we organize things together on infrastructure as well. And well, another thing that I kind of like about DevOps, like this guy defined, his name is John Willis. He came up with this acronym, CAMS, which defines what I think is the best definition for DevOps, in my opinion. So DevOps is these four things: culture, automation, measurement, and sharing. And they all together provide the best segregation of people, tooling, and culture in order to achieve the best results. And of course, we focus on best communication, best smaller delivery cycles, and we try to achieve that. So in 2011, a bit later than that, do you know this guy, anyone? He's quite popular, actually. Okay, at least among developers. Jess Humble, he defined continuous delivery. So one guy sleeping out there, it's nice. Okay, so continuous delivery, and yeah, if you read the principles of continuous delivery, is that build quality in, work in small batches. Well, we heard it somewhere already, like we heard it during Ilya's keynote. Computers perform really repetitive tasks, people solve the problems. Continuous improvement, everyone is responsible. So something, again, that's aligned very much with agile values. Something that is aligned very much what DevOps is trying to define, what is Lean trying to achieve. So, of course, continuous delivery has a bit more technical angle on how we organize things, but at the same time, it is a way to apply tools that we have and align it with the culture that we want to have. Okay, 2013. Another guy, you probably don't know him, but he's Jin Kim. He's the author of The Phoenix Project, actually quite a good book. And he defined the three ways of DevOps. One of them is system thinking. So devs and ops should operate together, and they actually try to optimize not their own department, like not just a load balancing department, but actually the whole product. So cross-functional teams and system thinking is something that is coming along the way. The second way of DevOps is amplify feedback. So we have to understand what we're getting when the application is running and producing customers and getting money out of that. We have to understand what's important in the system, how we can optimize. So the feedback should go around, not only about the customers, but also about how easy it is to operate the application itself. And the third way is culture of continual experimentation. So that's what Lean is about. That's what continuous delivery is about. That's what actually Agile is about. And what I really think, and I guess that's what kind of comes to minds of many people, is that Agile, Lean, continuous delivery, Scrum, Kanban, DevOps, they actually are trying to achieve the same thing. We're trying to achieve the same shorter delivery cycles, faster, okay, I have 4 minutes, that's nice. Now, faster value to production and getting feedback back. So all these models, all these different principles, they actually, in mathematical terms, they are isomorphic, which means that they are replaceable with each other. And in that regard, I mean, people continue creating models like that. And in that regard, the biggest segregation of these principles and tooling that came up in 2017 is GitOps. Have you heard about that? Probably not. I mean, it's actually a new word, but it's nothing new. We try to apply the same principles with the biggest integration we can have with the tooling. And in this case, the biggest tool is obviously Git. Git is the version control system. So we try as much as we can to describe everything as code and have an automatic pipeline that delivers that code into the real systems, production or staging or whatever we need. And of course, it's very technical. I mean, it's really about, you know, using Git efficiently and using any automation efficiently. But at the same time, it implies that we have a culture that actually supports that, and vice versa. So it doesn't mean that you have to go and implement that right away. It's just, you know, one of the ways you can do that, and this is like the biggest segregation you can find at the moment in the industry with the culture uniting the power of tooling and then amplifying the feedback from one to another. So effectively, what we are going at is that version control system quite often becomes a single source of truth, where we store information about how a business works. In terms of infrastructure, in terms of network, in terms of database, in terms of application development, in terms of, you know, HR processes, because pretty much everything is code and everything can be captured as that. A lot of things, except people, of course. You can actually, with the tooling that exists at the moment, we can express pipeline as code, documentation as code, trust as code, security as code, infrastructure as code, network as code, metric as code, documentation as code, anything as code, except people, obviously. But people have to support on a cultural level.
Not yet.
Sorry?
People as code, not yet.
No, of course not yet, yeah. To some. Well, I have 2 minutes, but I have a lot of material actually to cover, because the question is how we do that.
We'll have open space session tomorrow.
Yeah. So yeah, if anyone wants to join that, yeah, let's do that after that. Maybe let's not keep people from lunch.
No, we're not late, so we will have time for QA.
Okay, but I have maybe another 10 minutes of material, so okay. Okay, sorry guys, it was not my fault. let me go quickly of what are different ways in order to, you know, try to make these things together. And first of all, it's important, who do we need? What kind of people do we need? Probably you've heard about this term, T-shaped people. Have you? It's quite important that, you know, it's a term coming from psychology, and basically the idea is that, well, every person has some specialization. Some are system administrators, some are developers, some are product owners, some are designers, some are project managers. And of course, if you selected that profession, you will probably be good at that. But at the same time, in order to be efficient in all this, you know, context of tools and culture, you have to understand how all things work together. So you have to have a broad understanding of things, how they connected together. So we need T-shaped people. But in that regard, I mean, it's kind of funny to see that tweet. So that's the model. That's what we see in job ads, especially for developers. Like when people, managers expect developers to be like full stack or something. Also, this is like the real expectation of managers. Like you have to be master of everything, but what we actually are, usually that we have a deep understanding, a deep specialization in certain things, but we probably have some better knowledge in other areas. I think the model is nice, and I think that's what we should tend to, like broader understanding of the processes and deep understanding of our specialization. Another thing that quite often comes with companies I visit is that the way they plan is quite often is just bad. And in that sense, Jin Kim has this idea of unplanned work and how you should, you know, keep track on that, because quite often operations department, especially operations department, they are overloaded with unplanned work. They have too much to do about backups and restores and server restarts and all that stuff. And quite often developers and product teams and anyone who is kind of relying on the infrastructure that those guys support, they don't realize how much work actually it is to have a real infrastructure running and being efficient. And unfortunately, every failed build, every failed delivery, every failed feature will just increase the unplanned work, actually, for everybody. And of course, no company wants to be here. If the amount of unplanned work is going up, then, unhappy people, company is dying, people are leaving company, and nobody's happy. Of course, the idea is to implement the delivery pipeline of how you deliver changes, how you deliver features to production, in a way that the number of failed changes is kind of under control. Then, obviously, everybody will be more aware how the process works, will be fully codified, and then the amount of unplanned work will go down. Another thing that influences unplanned work quite a lot is the number of unique configurations. And that's maybe like more like operational term. But if you have too many operating systems, like different versions of them, different programming languages, different versions of middleware, different versions of features that you implement, and you have to support them all at once, that means that your mastery that you can apply to each one of these unique configurations will go down. So you cannot be mastering everything. You cannot be jack of all trades. So as a company, as a team, you have to optimize for like smaller number of configurations, like simplifying organization, as Ilya actually was mentioning during the keynote. And if you can minimize your configuration to the simplest possible set, and obviously the mastery level you can apply to each of those types of automation that you need or process that you need will grow. So the fewer things you have, the better you become at them. And this should be controlled on a team level and on the company level. And this obviously will force the unplanned work to go down. And that's something that managers and team leads and those who overview the teamwork have to be aware of. Because if they don't, unplanned work will kill them. Well, they kill the company, kill the team. You probably don't know this woman. She's like Dominica de Grandis. And I really like her book that is called Making Your Work Visible. And she came up with this ideas of time thieves. So quite often, unplanned work is invisible because people are not aware what is creating unplanned work. And if you make it visible, like if you know that there's some unknown dependencies, there's some conflicting priorities, there's some too much work in progress, that's all of that is waste. And if you're not aware of that, then it will create a lot of unplanned work for your members, for your teammates, and that's something that you don't want to. So obviously, reduce work in progress and say more no, reduce the scope, and focus. How we should work together? This guy came up with some other ideas. His name is Matthew Skelton. He's a DevOps consultant. He came up with a set of DevOps topologies of how different DevOps teams have to work together. I will not go through them because we have no time. But if you go to devopstopologies.com, you will find out different ways how people make devs and ops closer together in different ways. So that several good times. Another one, how much time I'm behind? Minus, yeah. Well.
Actually, we have 4 minutes till our lunch, yes. And
Okay. Let me finish, because I also have a game in the end. Let's try to play that. And I have a prize for the game winners. So I hope it will keep you up a bit. what should we use? Neil Ford, he's talking about that a lot, but he's not the one who came up with this chart. But basically, if we think about tools and all the ocean of tools that we have at the moment, we have to know what is the state of those tools and what is like industry and community and our company is doing about that. So there's like graph innovation curve where you have innovators, early adopters, early majority, late majority, and laggards. And this happens to every technology, every technique, every tool that is out there. This happens to Agile. This happens to Kubernetes. This happens to any other possible thing that happens in technology. And you have to understand where you are in that graph. Because obviously, you probably want to be here, like an early majority, because you kind of, so most of the problems have been solved for you already, and you still are adopting something that is relatively new. And you don't want to be here, because if you're adopting Agile like in 2025, that's maybe a bit too late. Okay. And ThoughtWorks, the company that Neil Ford is working for, they came up with this technology radar idea, where they put different technologies, different techniques, different languages on a radar. This radar has 4 rings: adopt, trial, assess, and hold. And every technique, they review this radar every 6 months, and they put different technologies, different techniques on different rings. So if adopt means that you have to use that right away. If it's trial, then you have to maybe try it, verify it, and see how if it works in your context. Assess means, just try to, see if it may be useful, and hold means don't use it at all. So, and it's actually quite fascinating to see how these different technologies are moving around this radar, because sometimes it could be that technology is moving from assess to trial to adopt, and then it's moving back to hold because some problem has been found, for example. And that's a thing that every company should do in terms of technologies and in terms of things that they use. I will not focus on that. It's quite, and the ThoughtWorks is making this radar public, but this radar is really something that they do for themselves. So I think for your companies, you have to do it yourself to have your context in this growth and navigation. So another thing, final thing. I promise, final thing. I really like this guy recently. His name is Simon Wardley. He came up with another technique to kind of map your company growth and company movement in the landscape of where industry is going and where you are according to the users. Basically, he came up with a mapping technique that is both visual and context-driven and situational, brings some situational awareness where your company is, where different techniques that your company using is. This is a huge example. This is one example of maps. I will not go too deep into that, but basically the idea is that you put everything on two axes, and the first axis is the value chain, where the most visible component to your users is placed on top. The less visible component is placed on like lower to the axis. And this axis actually is the evolution of the component that you have. So genesis means that you are building that, and you are the one who is like innovating. Custom build means that you maybe took some experience from other components and you put it on. And you added some custom build features to that. Product means that you actually are either renting that or buying it from someone else. It's good enough for the business. Maybe it's not as visible to the users as other parts, but it's something that you can buy and maybe resell. And commodity means that it's completely replaceable. You can buy it from any product, from any provider. It's kind of almost invisible. And in this case, we kind of trying to, you know, he tried to map what kind of different platforms you have. For example, compute resources like CPUs and servers. Maybe like 10 years, 15 years ago, 20 years ago, they were maybe custom built, and maybe some of them were rented. But nowadays, this technology is moving to full commodity. So you can buy infrastructure, you can get compute power almost from any cloud provider, and you can be like very fast with that. And it's really like becoming like electricity. And that's something you as a company, you as the CTO of the company or CIO of the company has to be aware of, because things are changing. And if you're still, let's say, building custom infrastructure yourself without a good reason for that, instead of buying it, then you'll soon be out of the market because other companies will just buy it and use it immediately. So it's quite an interesting technique. I'm still putting my head around that, but it's important, you know, to place a contextual situational awareness for where the company is going, where the tooling is, and how your company culture is evolving that. Okay, so final takeaways for me. So directions and planning as well as progress should be visible, and this should be shared, of course, because otherwise people are not aware of what is happening. They will optimize, if they don't know where the company is going, they will optimize for their own goals. So radars, maps, and boards, something that can help, you know, visualize that. Version control system, like Git, becomes more and more the single source of truth of how the company operates, what are the processes happening. Pipelines and all aspects of software delivery should be, pipelines should handle all the aspects. So any commit to the version control should kind of trigger a process that will actually deliver something either to the production or some other systems. And of course, my main message here is that which tools you use doesn't matter that much, but they may help to enforce your culture and vice versa. It's a cycle. Okay, I'm done.
Thank you. Applause to Andrei.